what will be an ongoing series of conversations about different aspects of sustainability. I would like first to thank the Free University's Environmental Policy Research Center, in particular Miranda Schreurs, and her assistants Inka Reiner and Nina Schrilo. And I thank the Environmental Policy Research Center for hosting this event, and also for helping so much with the preparations. I'd also like to thank Democrats Abroad, of course, for bringing Stephen Hill to Berlin again, and for supporting this event. And of course, my thanks go to Stephen Hill and Hans-Josef Fell for being our guests tonight. It's a great honor to have you here. Tonight launches a salon on sustainability issues that aims to create connections among Germans and Americans who work in the sustainability field or are just interested in becoming more active or informed. Our blog has been up and running for several weeks, and we aim to host fairly regular events for a general audience.
Renewable energy issues here, so we've asked if you will start us off today in the discussion, and then we'll turn over the discussion to Stephen Hill, who has written a very interesting book. I was reading through it in preparation for this evening, and Europeans can read this book and walk around and feel really proud. And Americans can read this book and say, oh boy, we've got some learning to do. So let me turn the floor over to Mr. Fell.
Yes, when I go to USA, I cannot understand why you do not have a health system that gives health for all the people, and how difficult is it for President Obama to bring a bit more? Yes, I know. And I see also in USA how problematic is it to understand climate change and climate protection and to make strategy for this. Yes, indeed, members, they cannot look to the economy. They are crazy. Talks to most people. But it is now, we did not reach the target of 12% in 2010, we reached already 17%. Much more, much earlier. So we believed in the society. We believed on the people that they will invest new money, that they will create a lot of new companies. And it happened. I believed it since a long time. I'm very happy to see such a scientific report. And this idea, it is possible to switch to 100% renewable energies, is a very, very, I think, was heißt Kampfansage?
Declaration of war.
Declaration of war to the oil industry, to the nuclear industry, and to others who earn money with destroying the climate and polluting the world with nuclear waste. And this industry, this oil, natural gas, coal and uranium, is the biggest industry in the world. The biggest business in the world. And this business should completely vanish in the world within 20 years. Allowance for more nuclear power for a longer period is not the best way that they will come. They need also the economic basis for this. And the economic basis means the growth of renewables must be stopped, because now they are a very, very important competitiveness. And when the growth will go on, we cannot use nuclear electricity and renewable electricity both, because we have too much of them, electricity. And therefore, we must cancel it. And when you look exactly into the new energy program of the government today in Germany, you will find this. The yearly increasing volume of renewable energy will be cut down very fast in the coming years. Onshore wind energy should be shut down about 60% yearly new investment, photovoltaics 75%, bioenergy 85%. This is the target of this energy program of the government. So we have the fight at the moment between, on one side, the old one companies, nuclear and coal companies, and on the other side, the fight for the climate protection and industry for renewable and expensive electricity. I learned from a new study from Duke University in North Carolina. They made a report. Today is the point of the turning point in the world. From today, electricity coming from photovoltaics, everyone thinks it is the most expensive electricity production. That today, electricity from photovoltaic becomes cheaper than from a new nuclear power station. It is already today.
People's ears perked up because it was good to get, in the U.S., we don't often get members of parliament, first of all, coming to places like San Francisco. In fact, I had a meeting at the European Commission a couple weeks ago and was talking to some of the directors general. You know, there's 27 departments in the European Commission. Each one is headed by a director general. And I said to them, when Chancellor Merkel or President Sarkozy comes to the United States, they only go to Washington, D.C. They don't go to Chicago or Philadelphia or Seattle or San Francisco. And, you know, American people need to hear from them and not have it filtered through the media in Washington, D.C. Hear directly from them. And this seemed to be a new concept that somehow it should go to other parts of the U.S. And I think that's true of members of Parliament. And American people need more face time from leaders in Europe, because what they're hearing about Europe is completely mediated by the news, which is not very good. It's mediated by the politicians and the so-called leaders, and you know, they have a different ideology and they use different things about Europe to bash Europe as a way to steer Americans away from looking at it. So it was great to have you in San Francisco, and I hope you and other members of the parliament come back and we have more forums like this. And it's good, I'm very, very equally thrilled to be here and to, as an American, to give you some thoughts about what's going on in the United States. And because I think this sort of transatlantic dialogue is more important now than perhaps it's ever been in the post-World War II period. The world is at a rather crucial moment. We're facing crises, an economic crisis, unlike any of us in this room have seen from a historical perspective, unless you were alive during the Great Depression. And we're facing an ecological crisis unlike we've ever seen before. So it's even more important, this transatlantic relationship, and yet there seems to be a turning aside right now where both America and the United and Europe are sort of saying the other isn't getting its act together and we're going to look east. I've heard this from a number of, when I was at a conference in Budapest, put on by the center-right, it was a think tank of the European People's Party, and they were saying the U.S. just can't get its act together, we can't wait, we have to look east. And in the United States, they're saying Europe looks like a mess because of this Greek debt crisis, they won't give us more troops for Afghanistan, we're going to have to turn east. And this is a rather astounding statement on both sides, as well as it's just the wrong path. Time after Obama had elected to show that a new leadership was here and that there was going to be a change. So everyone waited with sort of bated breath to see what was President Obama going to bring to the table. Well, President Obama came to the table saying we're going to reduce carbon by 17%. But in the fine print it said of 2005 levels. Well, everyone who talks about carbon reduction is always of 1990 levels. I don't know how they thought they could sort of slip that one by. And in fact, 17% of 2005 levels was about 3 to 4% of 1990. So, and that's practically a rounding error when it comes to carbon. So basically, President Obama came to the table with next to nothing. That gave the Chinese the excuse to do nothing. Europeans were like a jilted bride at the altar, so to speak. It was reported that, you know, Europe was showing again it was weak, it was impotent, it was unable to move its agenda. And it was reported in the United States that President Obama came to Copenhagen and actually saved the day by brokering a deal with the Chinese. But the fact was they shook hands with the Europeans out of the room to do precisely nothing. And so I call this the coalition of the underachievers,